1 Samuel 13, towards the end of the chapter is where we're going to start. 1 Samuel 13, verse 19. And then we're going to read all the way through 14, verse 32. All right, so that's a good bit of reading, but you know, the Apostle Paul, I keep reminding y'all, but we always have visitors. The Apostle Paul told young Timothy, who was a pastor of a New Testament church, he said, give attention to public reading of Scripture. All Scripture is inspired by God. What does the word inspired mean? It means God breathed. The word for inspired in the Greek is theo, God, neustos, breath, God breathed. God breathed the Scriptures in man, through man, to communicate with man. Amen? And God's Scriptures are good, profitable for instruction, for doctrine. What does that mean? To learn the things of God. You know, there's a movement in the modern church that comes against the word doctrine. They make fun of it. Oh, you go to one of them doctrine churches where, oh, they're so worried about teaching you the things of the Bible. Really? Oh, dude, run from that church. Run from a church that won't take its time to dissect the Word of God and to teach you the Word of the living God. You got to run. Because the truth and the power of God is found in His gospel.
Amen.
It's not just in some feel good, come up here, touch me on the head, slap some oil on me, and make me dance and giggle and all this kind of stuff. No! Come on. People going around crowing like roosters and barking like dogs. Let me tell you something. The true gospel will transform your life.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. All right. 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse 19. Now there was no smith found throughout all the land of Israel. Was a smith, a blacksmith. What does a blacksmith do? He forms. He forms various things. I mean, yeah, he works on horseshoes, but he also forms things out of metal. He forges metal objects.
He creates God.
In this particular situation, he forms weaponry. There was no smith found in all the land of Israel, for the Philistines said, lest the Hebrews make themselves swords or spears. So already, if you really stop and think, we have a situation that we've learned. Israel is under the dominion and bondage of their enemy, the Philistines. The Philistines have so much authority in Israel's life at this point in their life, that they've taken all the blacksmiths out of the land so that they could not forge swords, so that they could not forge spears, so that they could not have weaponry in order to fight against the enemy. I'm here to tell you right now that the enemy of your soul in the spiritual realm, he wants to make sure that you don't have any weapons. He wants to destroy your faith. He wants to contort the Scriptures in your mind. He wants to cause you to put your eyes on everything other than the real Jesus, to remove from you your true spiritual power, so that he can leave you helpless in the midst of your own land where you're supposed to be thriving, where God's power, amen, would give you strength in the midst of your walk. But all the Israelites went down to the Philistines to sharpen every man his share. That's a form of a hoe. And his coulter, it's another form of a hoe, probably more of a pointed one. And his axe, you know what an axe looks like, right? You chop down trees with it. And his mattock. A mattock would be a pointy type axe, a pickaxe. So what do we have here? We have a bunch of farm tools, right? And so what we see is Israel without true weapons, using farm tools in order to be their military weaponry. All right? It's kind of like it's a sad, sad situation is what it looks like to me. It says, yet they had a file for the mattocks and for the coulters and for the forks and for the axes and to sharpen the goads. A goad, we've talked about that many times. That was one of those pointed objects that possibly had some metal on the end of it that they would use to poke the flank of an animal. Because you remember, whenever the Apostle Paul was on his road to Damascus to get letters to throw the Christians in prison, the Lord struck him down with a light and said, why do you kick against the goads? In the King James, it may say pricks, but the word is goads. And that's what that word means. It's that instrument that you use to poke the flank of an animal to get him moving in the right direction. Paul was going in the wrong direction. You know, many times in our lives, and I know it sure is true for my life, that the Lord's over there poking me in my hind quarter.
Yeah.
He's saying, I need you to head in the right direction, but instead you're kicking against it like Paul was doing. We need to be careful to make sure that we don't continue to resist the voice of God whenever he's telling us to go in a certain direction. Amen?
Amen.
We don't want to get so far away from shore that we can't hear his voice anymore. Praise Amen. God. All right, so they had all of these farm implements for weaponry, and so it came to pass, verse 22, in the day of battle that there was neither sword nor spear found in the hand of any of the people that were with Saul and Jonathan, but with Saul and with Jonathan, his son, was there found. So basically what we're told here is that all of Israel, whoever, however many that there are, actually the story is going to tell us there were 600 fighting men. 600 fighting men, and amongst them there was only two men that had real weapons. One was Jonathan and one was Saul. Alright? And so it goes on to say, verse 23, and the garrison of the Philistines went out to the passage of Michmash. Let's see here. I had some maps I wanted to show you. Just real quick. I mean, I don't think that you can see all of the, I don't even know that I could find them, but here's the Sea of Galilee. I try to draw these pictures on the board for you sometimes. This is Mount Carmel where Elijah had his showdown with the prophets of Baal. Remember, I always show you this little hook in the by the Mediterranean Sea. And the Sea of Galilee, this is the Jordan River, and it flows all the way down to the Dead Sea right here. And somewhere right up in here, this is actually Michmash, is where the Philistines are in this story, and Gibeah is where Saul and his soldiers are. It's about a 4-mile journey. Michmash is a little bit northeast of Gibeah. So they're real close in proximity to where they are. And that's basically where our story's taking place. And this next map just is like kind of like more of a blow-up of the exact area where they are, Gibeah and Michmash, and where they were real close in proximity as the story goes on. Essentially, the story is going to be about Jonathan and his armor bearer. All right, and we're about to get into that. I'm about to finish reading it. But that was what I titled this morning's message, Will You Bear His Armor? Okay, and so it goes on. Now it says in verse 1 of chapter 14, now it came to pass upon a day that Jonathan the son of Saul said unto the young man that bare his armor, come and let us go over to the Philistines' garrison. A garrison is a military outpost that is on the other side, but he told not his father. And Saul tarried in the uttermost part of Gibeah under a pomegranate tree that is in Mignon. And the people that were with him were about 600 men. And Ahiah, the son of Ahitub, Ichabod's brother, the son of Phinehas, the son of Eli, the Lord's priest in Shiloh, wearing an ephod. And the people knew not that Jonathan was gone. That's a whole lot of information right there. You know, I think that the Bible wants us to really pay attention to that. You might have just glanced over that like, oh, okay, Ichabod, Phinehas, Eli, who really cares? No, the Bible told you that for a reason.
Yeah.
There's a whole lot of information right there. Well, who was Eli? Well, he was the high priest during the time frame of the judges before Samuel, the little boy, was given to him. He had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas. Hophni and Phinehas didn't live for the Lord. They weren't serving the Lord the way that they were supposed to, and they didn't care about the sacrifice of God. It said, the Lord said, why do you kick against my sacrifice? Because then when they took the fat portion of the animal and took it for themselves, and when they went to war, the Ark of the Covenant was stolen from them, which is the presence of God, and they died. And whenever they heard, the news came back that they died in the midst of battle and the Ark of the Covenant was taken. Eli died, and then Phinehas' wife died right there giving birth, and she gave birth to a child, and before she died, the last thing she said was, his name is Ichabod, and it means no glory. It means the glory of the Lord has departed. Because the Ark of the Covenant had departed, that means the presence of the Lord had departed, and because of everything that was going on in the midst of this situation, the Spirit of God had left the building. And so that's what the Scriptures want you to know. Saul has connected himself to the house of Eli, and that's his priest. All right? And so it goes on to say in verse 4, and between the passages, I'm sorry, and Ephod and the people, we're still in verse 3. And the people knew not, the second part of verse 3. And the people knew not that Jonathan was gone. So Saul's over here under a pomegranate tree with 600 fighting men. And he's hanging out on the pomegranate tree. And it just came a day whenever Jonathan told his armor bearer, hey, let's me and you go take a trip. Let's me and you go over to this Philistine garrison over here. And let's engage the battle, all right? And it says in verse 4, and between the passages, by which Jonathan sought to go over into the Philistines' garrison, there was a sharp rock on the one side and a sharp rock on the other side. And the name of the one was Bozez, and the name of the other was Sina. The forefront of one was situated northward over against Michmash, and the other southward over against Gibeah. And Jonathan said to the young man that bare his armor, "Come and let us go over unto the garrison of these uncircumcised." Now, you know what uncircumcised means, right? Spiritually speaking. I mean, you know what a circumcision is. I think they actually have to teach that in the class next door. Let me just go ahead and let you know the child Bible that we had mentioned the concept of circumcision. Teacher wanted to know, what am I going to do if the kids want to know what circumcision means? Well, it just, you tell them as best you can what it means in the physical, but that it has significant meaning in the spiritual. Amen. That in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament, circumcision was a sign that God was in covenant with Old Testament Israel. Amen. And in the New Testament, it says that now there's a circumcision of the heart. Amen? Right. See, the circumcision, what you got to understand is it represents the cutting away of filthy flesh through the shedding of blood. And the New Covenant, what is descriptive of, is a circumcision of the heart. When you put your faith in Christ, hallelujah, the old man that was born of Adam died in him. The Holy Spirit took residence on the inside of your heart. Amen. And performed a surgical procedure on your heart, where filthy flesh was cut away through the shedding of the Lamb of God, the blood of the Lamb of God. Amen. And it does something on the inside of you. I'm not here to tell you, come on. I'm not here to tell you that you get it right every day and that you still have it messed up after you gave your heart to Jesus. But what I'm saying is that when a circumcision of the heart takes place, you will never be the same.
Amen.
You're never going to be able to live just in the old way that you used to live without the Holy Spirit dealing with you. Amen. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. Yes. Hallelujah. You might have thought you ventured so far you couldn't hear his voice, but then he started speaking and then you started whispering. And when you said his name, all the beautiful name of Jesus, the presence of God started coming back. Hallelujah. And started drawing you back where you needed to go. These Philistines are uncircumcised. That's why young David walked up into camp and he asked the question, "Y'all gonna let this uncircumcised Philistine talk about our God this way? He's not even in covenant with the God that we serve." Oh, you gotta understand something. If you're in covenant with God today, how do I get in covenant, preacher? That's a good question. I know we're supposed to be reading, but I gotta tell you something. The way that you enter covenant with the God you serve is through faith.
Amen.
Oh, that doesn't tell me nothing. I know. They should have explained it to you a little bit better. Faith in what, preacher?
Mm-hmm.
Faith in the plan of God.
Amen.
What's the plan of God, preacher? It's real easy. His name is Jesus.
Amen.
God's been working a plan for thousands of years. Do you understand that? Mm-hmm. I know you do. He called a man named Abraham out. There was no nation called Israel. He called him out. He gave it. Abraham gave birth to Isaac. Isaac to Jacob. Jacob to 12 tribes who became the nation of Israel. Through Israel, God gave us Jesus. In Jesus, he's creating a new people. Faith in God's plan, which is Jesus Christ, and not just who he was. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Amen.
Not just who he was, not just his preaching, not just his miracle working power.
That's right.
See, most of the church today, that's what they want to focus on. Oh, I want to see the dead raised. Well, the only reason I need to see a dead man raised up physically is if he didn't know Jesus. Because if he didn't know Jesus, then he needs to be raised up from the dead so that we can witness Jesus to him and he can have the Lord living in his heart. Otherwise, let him go home and be with the Lord. If that was, see, the reason people want to see the dead raised from the dead is because they just, I'm telling you right now, many times it's built upon a wrong motivation. If I'm wrong, then forgive me. I'm not trying to pick on you. I used to say the same thing. Oh, we just want to see miracles. You know what Jesus told them? Come on. I keep saying it now that Ballard pointed it out. You know what Jesus told them whenever they came seeking a sign and a wonder? I'm just telling you what the Lord said. That's right. A wicked and an adulterous generation seeks after signs. He said the only sign you're going to see is the sign of the prophet Jonah. Well, what was the sign of the prophet Jonah? He was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. Well, what are you talking about, Lord? I'm talking about my death. I'm talking about my burial. And I'm talking about my resurrection. When you see that sign, not just think and you're seeing something, but then you got a revelation of it. When you see that sign and it gives birth on the inside of your heart and you're able to see it for what it really is, it begins to produce life on the inside of you. That's the kind of sign you must see. And until you see that, I'm just going to be honest with you, you're wasting your time looking for all those other ones.
Amen.
Can you really see that?
That's good.
Amen. All right, that's just one of my little soapbox things. Let's go back to reading.
That was awesome.
Thank you, Jesus. And it says in verse 6, "And Jonathan said to the young man that bare his armor, come and let us go over unto the garrison of these uncircumcised," these people that aren't in covenant with our God. I can't get off of that right now, but I mean, it's like, there's young David. And he's wanting to know, why is this uncircumcised Philistine breathing threats in our camp and we're over here cowering in the camp and allowing him to speak to us this way? And here we are, here's Jonathan. Why is my daddy sitting under a pomegranate tree and 600 men of Israel? Yeah, I know they only got farming tools, but why are we just sitting over here when the Philistine garrison is over there? I don't want to get to preaching too fast, but Jonathan's not happy with it. He said, "Let us go. It may just be that the Lord will work for us." Hallelujah. Somebody with a little bit of faith, taking a step in the right direction, going to engage the battle. It might just be that if you and I would head over there to the Philistine garrison, that God may just go work for us. Hallelujah. If we show a little bit of faith and we engage the battle. Amen. Do you need God to go to work for you?
Amen.
Amen. I don't know about you, but I need the Lord to go to work for me. Amen. It says, "For there is no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few." In other words, there's nothing that can hold back the hand of God. God is all powerful. God is all sovereign. It doesn't really matter. Yes, it matters to you what you're going through. Don't misunderstand me. And it matters to me. But it's not too big for God, is what I'm trying to say.
Amen.
Nothing can restrain him. Hallelujah. We have to believe that.
Amen.
No matter what we see.
That's right.
Hold on to Jesus.
Amen.
Even to the end.
That's right.
Come on.
Amen.
Listen.
Even if we don't see it.
That's right. Even if we never see it. Abraham never saw the promise.
Amen.
Does that bother you? I hope that doesn't make you cringe and want to get up and... Amen. God's got it under control. I don't want you to get frustrated with me. Oh, preacher, I wanted you to tell me I was going to get everything I wanted on this side of glory. Abraham never saw the promise fulfilled, yet he tarried.
Amen.
He held on to the promise. Yes, he wavered from time to time. Yes, he had some failures and some frustrations. But in the end, hallelujah.
Amen.
They call him faithful Abraham. Because he believed the promise of God regarding the plan of God.
Amen.
And he trusted the Lord in the midst of it all.
Amen. That's right. Thank you, Jesus.
I don't know about you, but that's what I want to say about
Amen.
That.
Amen.
When it's all said and done.
That's good.
It says in verse 7, "And his armor bearer said unto him, do all that is in thine heart. Turn thee, behold, I am with thee according to thy heart." Boy, I love that right there. I know I'm getting ahead of myself, but you know, I'm seeing Jonathan. I'm going to go ahead and let the cat out of the bag. Jonathan is a type of Christ, at least one concept in here. And here he is. He's moving forward in the battle. And here's his armor bearer. And he says, do all that is in thine heart. He just wants to be connected to his Lord. He wants to just follow him into the battle. He wants to do the will of God. Jesus has a plan. He said, it's my meat to do my Father's will. Amen. Mm-hmm. The true disciple of the Lord is going to learn what the Word of God says so that he can yoke himself up with the plan of God and move forward in that endeavor. Goes on to say in verse 8, "Then said Jonathan, behold, we will pass over unto these men and we will discover ourselves unto them." In other words, we will reveal ourselves to them. "If they say thus unto us, tarry," meaning wait until we come to you, "then we will stand still in our place and will not go up unto them." And then, but then in verse 10 it says, "But if they say thus," if they say this to us, "come up unto us, then we will go up, for the Lord has delivered them into our hand, and this shall be a sign unto us." So it seems as though they're saying, come on up to us. And so what's happening is that the Lord is really, instead of them rushing them, the Lord is really kind of going to maybe make them stay still. And he's going to give Jonathan, because they climbed up a rock. That's why I got this picture right here. I want you to see that. They climbed up a rock. And so to say, they're really going to laugh at him. That's what's going to end up happening. Oh, they came out the mountains in the caves. Look at the little Hebrew boys. They were hiding. Come on up unto us. They're full of pride and arrogance. And it's giving Jonathan an opportunity and his armor bearer to move forward into the battle. It says, verse 11, and both of them discovered or revealed themselves unto the garrison of the Philistines. And the Philistines said, behold, the Hebrews come forth out of the holes where they had hid themselves. And the men of the garrison answered Jonathan and his armor bearer and said, come up to us and we will show you a thing. And Jonathan said unto his armor bearer, come up after me, for the Lord has delivered them into the hand of Israel. Praise the Lord. And Jonathan climbed up upon his hands and upon his feet, and his armor bearer after him. And they fell before Jonathan, talking about the Philistines, fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer slew after him. A great battle. Amen. And that first slaughter which Jonathan and his armor bearer made was about 20 men within, as it were, a half acre of land which a yoke of oxen might plow. And there was trembling, and the point to that is that that these 20 men fell in a short period of time. It's about the time, not very big field of land, about what a yoke of oxen would plow in a day. And they're on the run, but Jonathan and his armor bearer are slaying them. Amen. God's giving them victory over this 20 men. And in verse 15 it says, and there was trembling in the host in the field. That's talking about the army. The word host means army. And among all the people, the garrison and the spoilers, they also trembled, and the earth quaked. So it was a very great trembling. See, God's showing up. The earth's starting to quake.
Amen.
Jonathan believed God by faith. He took the first step. He moved forward in the battle, and now all of a sudden, the supernatural is starting to engage. God's starting to let the earth quake. And it says, and the watchmen of Saul in Gibeah of Benjamin looked. So here we have the watchmen. I don't know much about military, but I've heard of recon forces. And they usually send reconnaissance out to spy out the land to see what's going on. Jonathan and his armor bearer have left the camp, left his daddy under the pomegranate tree, have engaged the battle. But yet Saul has some watchmen, some recon men that have gone forward, and what they're seeing is all this skirmish that's taking place. It says, the watchmen of Saul and Gibeah of Benjamin looked, and behold, the multitude melted away. Talking about the Philistines. The description is that they're stricken with confusion and fear, the Philistines are, and they start to run in all kind of manner of direction. They're just all confused, and there's no organization in the midst of what they're doing. That's what the Lord wants to do, by the way, for the enemy in your life. You trust him by faith, and he will begin to cause confusion in the enemy's plans, amen. And just as you thought that everything was coming to the end and that there was no hope, God will flip this thing around and he will give you the victory in your life that you've been looking for. Amen. And it says right here that in the multitude was still in verse 16. The multitude melted away and they went on beating down one another. So they started beating each other. The Philistines did. Then said Saul unto the people that were with him. Now all of a sudden Saul has gotten attention to this. And so he's been made aware of it. Number now and see who has gone from us. So he takes a census. He wants to know what's going on over there. The watchmen have sent word to Saul. There's a skirmish going on. The Philistines are getting whooped. And now all of a sudden Saul's like, well, hold on a second. How many is everybody here? We got to take account. Did some of our people leave and we didn't know? He didn't even know that his own son has left the camp. And so they begin to number, and who has gone from us? And when they had numbered, behold, Jonathan and his armor bearer were not there. And Saul said to Ahiah, bring here the ark of God, for the ark of God was at that time with the children of Israel. So they had obviously gotten it back from when they lost it, but the presence of God really wasn't with them anyway. The presence of God was with Jonathan on the battlefield. So you can go fetch the ark, you can go fetch all your religion and all of your little church stuff, but the reality of it is that the Lord is with the true church in the midst of the battle, and we're going to get to that in a second. It says in verse 19, it came to pass while Saul talked unto the priest, that the noise that was in the host of the Philistines went on and increased. And Saul said unto the priest, withdraw thine hand. And Saul and all the people that were with him assembled themselves, and they came to the battle, and behold, every man's sword was against his fellow, and there was a great discomfiture. What does that mean in verse 20? Every man's sword was against his fellow. It means the Philistines were killing each other. God had caused confusion in the camp so much, because remember, Israel ain't got no swords. Only two swords in the camp, Jonathan and Saul. One of them's on the battlefield, the other one's under a pomegranate tree. But when Saul shows up, the Philistines had begun to turn their swords upon each other. Now this is the thing, in the book of Deuteronomy, before Israel ever entered into the promised land, God gave a promise to Israel: when you trust me by faith and you go into the promised land, I will cause confusion on your enemy.
Yes.
Amen. He promised that he would do that. Amen. And God still does that for his people today.
Amen.
Yes.
You think the enemy thinks he's got you hemmed in? I'm telling you right now, he thinks he got me hemmed in. Amen. Sometimes. Come on.
Amen.
But the enemy doesn't have the last say so in your life. The God you serve has the last say so in your life.
Amen.
He will show up. Amen.
Amen.
Says in verse 21, moreover, the Hebrews that were with the Philistines before that time, which went up with them into the camp from the country round about, even they also, hold on a second. Yes. Even they also turned to be with the Israelites that were with Saul and Jonathan. What does that mean? It means that some of the Hebrews in the past had defected and gone back into the world. We don't want to get ahead of ourselves, but you understand what I'm saying. They went back to play with the enemy. The people of God went back to play with the enemy. It says right here, verse 22, no enemy, I'm saying, no enemy, you're not going to have the people of God.
Amen.
We're not going back to the enemy's camp.
Amen. Right.
We're not going back to the ways of the world.
Amen.
The world doesn't have anything to offer us.
That's right.
And you might have to be convinced about it again from time to time, but I'm here to tell you, if you got Jesus living in your heart, you ain't never going to feel at home with the uncircumcised Philistine.
Thank you, Lord.
Says right here, verse 22, likewise, all the men of Israel which had hid themselves in the Mount Ephraim, when they heard that the Philistines fled, even they also followed hard after them in battle. So we got two situations here. We got people that have left the church and gone back to the world, and we got people that were hiding in fear. And now all of a sudden, when victory's on the battlefield, everybody's eyes are being opened and they're all coming back to where they're supposed to be coming back. Amen. Hallelujah. So the Lord saved Israel that day, and the battle passed over unto Bethaven, verse 24. And the men of Israel were distressed that day, for Saul had adjured the people, saying, cursed be the man that eats any food until evening, that I may be avenged on mine enemies. So none of the people tasted any food. That's a real important part of this story. I want you to see that.
Yeah.
Verse 24. The men of Israel were distressed that day. It means to be oppressed. A burden was on them. The reason why was because Saul made them take an oath. And the oath that he made them take was that they couldn't eat any food. He wanted them to fast on the day of battle. But what I need you to understand is that not only, now it'd be one thing if the Lord told him to fast.
Right.
But what we're going to see here is that when the Lord tells you to fast, you're not distressed. And when the Lord tells you to fast, you're filled up with strength and power spiritually in order to accomplish what it is that God has called you to do. But there's many times that men are calling for a fleshly fast, and the result isn't victory, but instead the result is oppression and distress.
That's right.
And we're going to talk about that
in
a second.
Yes.
And so it goes on to say, verse 25, and all they of the land came to the wood. See, they hadn't tasted any food. And look, when they came to the wood, what does that mean? To the woods. And there was honey on the ground. Now, how would you like to see that? You haven't eaten all day long. Saul the king told you not to put any food to your lips. And then all of a sudden, you walk in the woods after you've been fighting, and you're distressed, and you're famished, and there's honey just bubbling on the ground. It goes on to say right here, verse 26, and when the people were coming to the wood, behold, the honey dropped, but no man put his hand to his mouth, for the people feared the oath. But Jonathan, he heard not when his father charged the people. Why? Because he wasn't under the pomegranate tree. He was busy going forth into the battle. So he didn't hear his daddy say, don't put no food in your mouth, because today we're going to go into battle. No, he's like, no, I'm going to battle. Now Jonathan didn't hear him. And so he put forth the end of his rod that was in his hand, and he dipped it in the honeycomb. And he put his hand to his mouth, and his eyes were enlightened.
Amen.
Hallelujah. His eyes were enlightened. It was like light came to his eyes. He was filled up with something. He was given some supernatural power. He was ready to go again. Amen. All right. Verse 23, verse 28. Then answered one of the people and said, your father straightly charged the people with an oath, saying, cursed be the man that eats any food this day. And the people were faint. means to be weakened to the point where they really couldn't go any further. Then said Jonathan, my father has troubled the land. See, I pray you how mine eyes have been enlightened because I tasted a little of this honey. In other words, what my daddy told us was wrong.
Yeah.
My daddy has troubled the land. He's troubled the people. Look what this honey has done for me. In case I don't get to the point, let me make this point right now. Whenever you start finding the truth.
That's right.
I said, when you start finding the truth.
Amen.
The religious establishment is not going to want you to walk in the truth.
Amen.
They're going to want you to follow their rules and their regulations.
Amen.
And how dare you find honey on the ground and allow it to touch your lips and allow it to touch your tongue. No, no, you're going to earn your way to your victory. But what the Lord has provided is honey just dropping from heaven onto the ground and ready for you to just partake of it and to be enlightened, hallelujah, and to be strengthened by the power of God. That's how God works.
Amen.
You're not going to earn nothing from Him.
That's right.
He's asking for your faith.
Amen.
For your faith in His plan. Okay. And when you do that, honey drops like grace. Amen?
Amen.
Goes on to say right here, verse 29, then said Jonathan, my father has troubled the land. Verse 30, how much more if happily, in other words, how much greater would the victory have been had the people eaten freely today of the spoil of their enemies which they found? For had there not been now a much greater slaughter among the Philistines? And they smote the Philistines that day from Michmash to Ajalon, and the people were very faint. And the people flew upon the spoil. This is where we're ending. People flew upon the spoil and took sheep and oxen and calves and slew them on the ground, and the people did eat them with the blood.
Uh-oh.
First thing I wanted you to know about this morning's message was that I was seeing Jonathan in two different lights. Number one, he represents the remnant church. Now, what do I mean by the word remnant church? Because you see, all throughout the scriptures and all throughout the economy of God, God has always had a remnant. Amen? You understand what I'm saying? Like, in other words, there's a big old portion of Israel, and there's a big old portion of the church. But what I need to get inside of your head, whether you come back to church next week or not, I hope you can make it, you might find another church. It's possible. Some of you live out of town. Some of you can't make it here every week. I understand that. It's not my job to try to make you come to this church. It's my job to speak the truth.
Amen.
Amen. And to let God do what He desires to do on the inside of you. What I need you to know is this. There's always been a big portion that called themselves Israel. The Apostle Paul said, all that is Israel is in Israel. But those which are of faith. And most of Israel is sitting under a pomegranate tree, whereas the remnant, Jonathan represents the remnant church, has moved on and engaged the battle. I need you to know that there's a remnant church even today. I need you to understand that the big old thing that calls itself the church out there, I'm just going to go ahead and say it like I see it. Whenever you flip through the channels and you allow your TV to light up on TBN, I hate to say it, but the majority of what you're watching there is not the remnant church.
Amen.
It's not. You're going to see a whole lot of fluff. You're going to see a whole lot of flair. You're going to see golden chairs and chandeliers. You're going to see all kind of people doing all kind of things. But the reality of it is that if you would match up what they're saying out of their mouth to the word of the living God, and you would do your due diligence to read the scriptures and study them, you would find out that they're preaching another gospel, another Jesus. It has another spirit connected to it, and it will not bring true freedom. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Amen.
There's a big old movement going on out there, and there's all kind of fasts and all kind of fads, and we're going to get to it in a second, but I'm here to tell you, God has a remnant church, and they're engaging the battle.
That's right.
So He's the remnant church. He walks in the spirit, not in the flesh, versus the apostate church. It looks spiritual. Now listen to me. Don't get mad at me. Oh, preacher! I was watching TBN this morning! You had to do it, huh? You had to step on my toes! Hold on a second, don't get mad at me. I'm trying to make a point. There's an apostate church. There's a harlot that rides the back of a seven-headed beast in the book of Revelation.
Amen.
And she is deception. And she's been deceiving the masses for thousands of years. And God's heart is broken. Because his people can't see the truth. Because they've been intoxicated with the wine of her fornication. Her false doctrine has crept into the church. And what she does looks spiritual.
That's right.
What she does has the name of Jesus in it. What she does looks like it's good because it's all built upon social work, social community, feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and doing all of these things, but not telling the truth of the gospel. Amen. That liberates the soul that's Amen. In bondage.
Amen.
It's a big difference between the remnant church and the apostate church.
That's right.
You need to be able to distinguish the difference between the two.
Amen.
You need to get into the word. A workman that rightly divides the word of truth, he need not be ashamed.
Amen.
If you know what the essence of the gospel is, then I'm going to tell you it's real easy. It's Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's why Paul said it. We preach Christ crucified. Why do you keep talking about the cross, preacher? Because you see, I got family members and I got friends that said we got to move past the cross.
Mm-hmm.
They said we got to move past the cross and move on to the Holy Spirit.
Uh-oh.
Oh, hold on a second. Amen. The Holy Spirit don't move without the cross.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
The Holy Spirit works in unison with the finished work of Christ.
That's right.
You see, why is that, preacher? Well, let's go ahead and just go ahead and do it.
Let's do it.
Because, oh man, it's been a while since we drew it. Why? Because there's no access.
Yeah. Exactly.
Do you understand that?
Yeah.
You know what access means? Entree. Access means entree. It means that out here in this God-forsaken world, there's a bunch of sin out here, a bunch of power of sin, a bunch of oppression, and I can't get access, but faith in Christ gives me access.
Amen.
To be translated from one place into another place.
That's right.
To be brought into the presence of God. Into a new kingdom where God's grace abounds. How did that happen? How much did I have to fast to get there, preacher? How much did I have to read to get there, preacher? How many times did I need to go to church? Which ministry did I have to sign up for? I missed your baptism 2 weeks ago. How do I get there, preacher? It's real easy. You were born like your father Adam. You had no access. You were born in the bondage of sin, but God had a plan. That's why I keep talking about the plan. And you can't move past the cross because the cross is the plan of God. Why? Because man born of Adam has been born in sin. Listen to me, I keep talking about it because it's such a beautiful revelation.
Yes.
Whenever God put man in that garden, man was pristine. The garden was pristine. Whenever man fell, what did God do? He banished them from the garden,
yes.
from the very presence of God. And he put two cherubim out there with flaming swords,
yes.
representing judgment, representing no entree, representing no access to the presence of God.
Okay.
But since that day, God has been moving forward with his plan. And his plan required an innocent sacrifice. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our
Amen.
Lord. And God has been working this plan for thousands of years. That's why it all makes sense. That's why only the message of the finished work of Christ makes any sense. Because it's the glue that holds it all together. It is the gospel.
Amen.
Man is born in sin. God has a plan. What's his plan? His plan is Jesus. Amen? And so that's what he did for thousands of years.
Mm-hmm.
He worked the plan. How many times have I said it already? Three? Let's say it again.
That's right.
He called a man named Abraham out. He gave him a son named Isaac. Isaac had 12 sons.
Mm-hmm.
Isaac had Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons. They became the 12 tribes of Israel. Israel gave birth to Jesus. Jesus is giving birth to a new people. God has a plan. His name is Jesus. But listen, it's not just Jesus what he did, who he is. It's Jesus what he did. And it requires faith in him and what he did. And when you put your faith in that, a miracle happens.
Mm-hmm.
How old were you when you got saved? Were you in the 8th grade? Oh, but I don't think I was really saved there, preacher. Well, you may have been. The problem was is that you just didn't know what to keep your faith in.
Amen.
Amen.
See, you may have very well been saved.
That's right.
But in order to walk with God, you got to understand, you don't need to know nothing to get saved, hardly.
Amen.
Other than that Jesus died on the cross for your sin. But in order to walk with him, I'm going to tell you what the problem is with the church. In order to walk with him, you got to know some stuff. And ain't nobody today knows any stuff.
No.
And that's not all about puffed up knowledge.
No.
But it's about knowing the right thing so you can keep your faith in it so you can receive grace.
Amen.
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 And when you put your faith, when you were born like your father Adam, this is how you were born the first time. You put your faith in Jesus Christ and him crucified, which is the plan of God. The Holy Spirit put you in him and you became one with him in his death, his burial, and his resurrection from the dead.
Thank you, Jesus.
You are a new creation.
You
are a new creature. You are now, the old man is dead and the new man has been resurrected. Yeah, but you don't know what I did last night, preacher. Listen to me. I didn't say you were perfect.
That's right. Amen.
What I said was, in the mind of God, you are a new man.
Amen.
And if you continue to believe that, hallelujah, the Holy Spirit is going to give you strength and he's going to right the ship.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Lord.
And so, I don't even remember where we were other than there's a remnant church and there's an apostate church.
Yes.
And the apostate church isn't going to tell you.
That's right.
The apostate church is caught up and focused in everything else. And they're telling you, oh, we got to move past the cross. I'm feel like dropping names today. Kenneth Hagin said back in 1990-something, he said, this is what Kenneth Hagin said, the cross was the greatest failure known to man.
Oh.
We got to move past the cross. Kenneth Copeland said, when his blood poured out, it did not atone. I'm not telling you something somebody told me. I'm telling you things I read.
That's right. They said it.
When his blood poured out, it did not atone.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to sit there and you're going to watch them on television and they're going to say everything that you want them to say. Mm-hmm. Does it bother you? I'm going to keep bringing this up, but does it bother you? Oh, you want to look that up for yourself? And I don't care whether they said it in 1980. They ain't never publicly denounced it.
That's right.
That's right.
What does the deceiver do?
Deceive.
What does the spirit of Antichrist do? We already learned this in our study of the book of Revelation and the book of Daniel. This doesn't have anything to do with my message, but listen. He speaks in riddles. He says one thing on the front end, but he's really doing something else.
Yes.
What does it mean to you? So if you want to look that up for yourself, look up Google Word of Faith Heresies. Word of Faith Heresies.
He said any of us could have done that.
Go ahead. Yep, he said a lot of things. Write that down if you Google Word of Faith heresies. And you will see documentation of the shows, the date. You can order it.
Yep.
Of the things that they said.
That's right.
Benny Hinn said on stage, I see it now, I see it. There's three trinities. Yes, you heard me, right? There's three fathers, three sons, three Holy Spirits.
What? Oh, my God.
I don't know why he said that. He said it. It's documented. There's all kinds. Now, listen, I understand people make mistakes from behind the pulpit. But this stuff isn't accidental.
That's right.
Why would the Pope align? Why would Kenneth Copeland align himself with the Pope about a month and a half ago?
That's right.
Dude, that's a problem.
Amen.
Have you ever heard of the ecumenical church?
Mm-hmm.
It's part of a new world order.
That's right.
Yes.
We're on the brink of something happening.
Yes.
Deception. You thought it was going to look like David Koresh?
No.
You thought it was going to look like Jim Jones? Don't worry, we won't ask you to drink any Kool-Aid at this church. But what I'm trying to tell you is this. Oh, it's going to be much more slippery than that. It's going to look right. It's looking like it's spiritual. But the reality of it is that it's not the right thing.
It's not the right thing.
Lord, help us. To be able to see, this isn't a game.
That's right. That's right.
This isn't a game that we're in.
That's right.
As I say it, the Holy Spirit's dealing with my heart. This isn't a game.
That's right.
The enemy wants to destroy you.
That's right.
He wants to destroy me. He doesn't want us to know the truth. He wants us to believe a lie. He wants to destroy our soul and all of the countless people that we come into contact with.
Oh, Jesus, help us.
We can't always see it right now, but I'm telling you, it's more real than the chair that you sit in. So Jonathan represents the remnant church. It's not that big old thing that you're looking at when you watch TV. Whereas Saul, under the pomegranate tree, represents the apostate church. Remember, he's real spiritual. He's got a fast going on right now. Number two, Jonathan is also a type of Christ, and his armor bearer is a type of Christ. I'm sorry, and his armor bearer, I messed up, that's a typo. Jonathan is a type of Christ, and his armor bearer is a type of the true disciple wearing the Lord's armor. Amen. So that was the title of the message, Will You Bear His Armor? Amen. All right, so let's just look a couple of things that I want to go back and look at is I want to look at this, the remnant church real quick versus the apostate church. And the first point that I wanted to make is that the apostate church doesn't have any real tools. They don't have any real spiritual weapons. The Word of God says in the book of Corinthians that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Casting down vain imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself above the knowledge of God. Now, I used to think back in the day when we were having our Bible study that the way that you did that was you got a bunch of scripture and you quoted it. Now, I don't have a problem with quoting scripture. But I thought that my faith in quoting scripture was going to allow me to cast down vain imaginations. I'm here to tell you there's only one thing that will give you victory, and it's this right here. Faith in what Christ has done, continued faith in what he did, allows grace to flow. And listen to me, you need to understand this. Grace is something that is given to you by the person of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Ghost shows up, he starts changing your mind, and he starts giving power to you so that you don't have to continue to do what you used to do. It's the Holy Spirit moving and operating in the midst of the circumstance. It's not you and your flesh doing a whole bunch of religious activity.
Thank you, Lord.
There's nothing wrong with memorizing scripture so you know the Word of God. We don't have time to get into what really happened over there whenever Satan tempted the war. I don't have time to go there. But what I will tell you is this. Is that the apostate church doesn't have spiritual weapons with which to fight. The next thing I wanted you to notice is that the apostate church is tarrying under a pomegranate tree. He's over there sitting under a pomegranate tree. He's got a fast going on, and it all looks real spiritual. But the reality of it is that they're not even engaging the real battle. The remnant church is engaging the real battle, taking a chance, standing up, moving forward into the battle. We're going to reveal ourselves to this enemy, and we're going to fight. Listen to me. Most churches that you went and visited this morning, they would never tell you what I'm about to tell you. And I hope that it sounds ridiculous to you when I tell you. You're supposed to be a witness for Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Listen to me. When you're working at Walmart, I'm not putting pressure on you. When you're working at wherever you're working, wherever you are. Now, I'm not telling you to stand up on the table like the preacher might. Hey, you need to know about Jesus. That's not what I'm telling you to do. But what I'm telling you is this. You are supposed to allow the light of God to shine in you and through you.
Amen.
You are supposed to be a personal witness for the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And the body of church ain't going to say that. Not. Let me tell you why. Because in most modern churches, it makes people feel uncomfortable. And what they think church is that we all come up to the front and we get our little frissons, our little goosebumps. We get a little feel good. The preacher didn't step on my toes. He didn't challenge me to be a witness. I go home and I eat some pork roast. I love pork roast, by the way. Especially when my mother-in-law stuffs it with garlic. We go home and eat some pork roast. I'll go back to work on Monday and everything's copacetic. Don't shake the boat, preacher. I'm here to tell you right now, you aren't engaged in the real battle. You're part of the apostate church sitting under a pomegranate tree. And the enemy's right over there. And the Lord wants you and I to take our light and to reveal the light of Jesus to a lost and a dying world. That's the one of the differences between the apostate.
Thank you, Lord.
One of the things, though, about this apostate church is this oath. Saul told them to take this oath not to eat any food. And what I told you was is that if it's a fast instituted by the Lord, fasting is a good thing.
Yes.
But when it's a fast or a fad instituted by the fleshly heart of man, it's a bunch of garbage.
Amen. Right.
And the apostate modern church has been built upon fad after fad after fad after fad. Any of y'all been saved since the 1980s? Raise your hand. Come on. Hallelujah. Anybody y'all been saved since the 1990s? I know I'm not asking for the whole folks, but y'all understand. Everybody that's been saved that long and before, you know better than I do how many fads have ripped through the church in that time.
Amen.
Oh, I got some listed right here. Y'all ready? The Daniel fast.
Yes.
You may have taken part of the Daniel fast. I'm not picking on you. All I'm trying to say is, though, the Daniel fast is going to come. The Daniel fast is going to go. The prayer of Jabez.
Yeah.
I prayed the prayer of Jabez.
Uh-huh. Me too.
And you know what? God answered the prayer. But you know what? It wasn't the way I thought it was. Amen. I said, Lord, enlarge my territory. But he had me being a witness all the way from home of the Capitol. I was working in home and telling people about Jesus, driving all the way to Capitol on Sunday, teaching a curriculum about the cross, and going to church in Franklin in between and telling people about Jesus. And he was using me. He enlarged my territory. Yeah. What I thought.
Yeah.
But it was according to his will. Because he wants witnesses in the land.
Right.
Prayer Jabez. Come and go. Promise keepers.
Mm.
Oh, I'm going to find me an accountability partner. I'm going to tell you all my business. And you're going to help keep me straight.
Yeah.
Promise keepers. Come and go. Purpose driven life. Come and go. Celebrate recovery. That was from Rick Warren. That's what you're going to get your victory from. Celebrate recovery. What in the world is Rick Warren? Come on, somebody. Help me out. I'm going to be nice. Jesus culture. Uh-oh.
Yeah.
Y'all didn't know where Jesus... Do y'all know the story behind Jesus culture? Jesus culture is a youth group that comes out of a church in Redding, California. Some of the songs that they do are good songs. They're redoing some old hymns. Some of their stuff. Danielle bought me a CD one time. Back when I was really hearing from the Lord, I stuck that CD in there. I took it out and threw it out the window. It was a bunch of Eastern mystical music that had a bunch of words connected to it. And I didn't hear Jesus one time in any of them songs that was on that whole CD. I understand that they've redone some songs, but that's not even the problem. I'm not trying to pick on people. Y'all think I'm trying to pick on people. I've said it a couple times in the last few weeks. Listen, when you do a research on Redding, California, what they're doing, they're looking for some glory cloud. They're looking for something to descend in the midst of their service. Once again, fads, fasts, signs, wonders, sitting under a pomegranate tree, waiting for something to happen to give me the frisons so that I can feel good.
Amen.
So, no, you got to engage the battle, man. You got to be a Jonathan. You got to be an armor bearer to your Jonathan. And you got to let Jesus live in you and live through you. And the only way you're going to do that is if you get the hold of the real one.
Amen.
Jesus Calling, that's the new one. Y'all knew that. I hope y'all don't have that book. If you got that book, you need to take that book and throw it away. You know what I said? Jesus Calling, garbage. If you're teaching that at your church, it's garbage. It comes from a book that was called God Calling. Whenever she did through automatic writing, she was a psychic. She was into the occult. Or he was, whoever the first one that wrote God Calling, and this is where the woman took the premise. She wrote the book in the sense that it's like Jesus talking to you.
Hmm.
I'm telling you right now, and these fads, they come and they go, and the apostate church has fads that come and go, and they tell you to leave the cross and to move on. And what I'm trying to tell you is that Jeremiah said, you need to seek the old ways.
Yeah.
God never changes. Oh, and they told me this, man. I went to school, I got my degree, and they were all into all this stuff. And I've been around modern preachers, and they're like, God doesn't change, but times change. And we'll never change the message, but we're going to change the method. That's foolishness. Foolishness. God has chosen to use the foolishness of preaching to confound the wise. God doesn't change his ways. He wants the gospel preached, the truth told, so that his people can hear it and choose to believe it and begin to walk in it and see the power of it.
Amen.
Last thing I wanted to tell you real quick about the apostate church was because they got all a bunch of fads and fasts, there's no presence of God in that.
Hmm.
Remember what I told you about Ichabod?
Yes.
That's their priest. The brother of Ichabod. The glory of the Lord has departed. The presence of God is gone. That's why you're never going to see any true victory in the apostate church. Because listen, whenever you get a revelation of what happens here, the old man dies, a new man is resurrected, there is true power and true victory. God starts to deal with the at the level of the desires of the heart. Not just the outside, not working some program.
Right. Amen.
That's why the program can't work.
That's right.
See, the apostate church would tell somebody in the church whenever they say, man, I'm struggling with lust, preacher. And at first, it's not that big of a deal because he's not taking up that much of your time. So you give him a little, you know, read some scripture, do a little prayer. But then next thing you know, it's not working.
Right.
So because you know what's not working? Because we're not preaching the truth.
That's right.
And people aren't willing to hold on to the truth.
Amen.
And so now we have to have come up with another plan. Oh, yours is bad. You need professional help.
Yes.
So what you need is the professional help. You need Jesus.
Amen.
And you can't change the story. It doesn't matter whether you get it today or tomorrow, even next week. You can't let go. You got to hold on to the truth. You got to hold on to Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That alone gives victory. That alone is what's going to set the captive free. But when the apostate church doesn't even know it, the preacher sure can't tell it to you.
That's right.
We're not looking. Listen, there ain't no. Don't look at the man just because he's going to try to tell you the truth. Don't look over here.
Amen.
I need the same Jesus you need. I need the same cross you need. Matt needs to die just like you got to die. But I'm going to tell you right now, this stuff works.
Yes, it does.
This is the gospel, the eternal gospel, and it works. But listen, any church is only as strong as what the individual members are. And so not only is Jonathan a type of the remnant church, he's also a type of Christ. And the armor bearer is a type of a true disciple. Amen?
Amen.
The true disciple engages the battle. You heard that. He told his young armor bearer, come on, let's go. He's engaging the true battle. He's being a witness, a servant, a warrior for the Lord. He's on the battlefield. You understand that? Whenever I realized, when the Lord woke me up from my slumber, I realized that I wasn't even in the game. Now, that may not mean anything to you, but my dad used to tell me when I was growing up, boy, do not sit on that bench. I'm telling you right now, the last thing you want to do is sit your hiney on that bench. You need to go over there, you need to stand by that coach, and you need to bug him until he puts you in the game. And that's what I did. He said, don't let me see you sitting on that pine. You bug that coach till they put you in the game. And when you get in there, then it's time to shine.
Yeah.
And what I'm telling you is after I woke up from my sleep, I realized I wasn't even in the game. I thought I was doing church, y'all.
Yeah.
And the reality is that I wasn't being a personal witness for Jesus to save my life. And I'm not telling you to get out there and to do it in your own strength or your own flesh. Exactly. You can't do that. If you try, you will mess it all up. Yeah. But if you go to the Lord and you learn who you are in Christ and you see the grace of God changing you, you're going to see His beauty so clearly, you're going to want somebody to know about the Jesus that you got told. Amen. Next thing I wanted you to see was, look at this in verse 4. I want you to see the pathway that they took. And between the passages by which Jonathan sought to go over unto the Philistines' garrison, there was a sharp rock on the one side and a sharp rock on the other side. And the name of the one was Bozez, and the name of the other was Sinon. This is, I Googled to find this spot. This is the passage right here. You see these sharp rocks on each side. I just thought that was interesting. But look at what these words mean. Bozez means surpassing white, glistening. And Sinon means thorny. And I was just thinking, isn't that just something? That here's a type of Christ with the armor bearer following behind him. One side is glistening white. I don't know what it means to you, but it reminds me of righteousness. It reminds me of the perfection of the Christ. The other side is thorny. It reminds me of his crown of thorns. And here he is, his perfect righteousness, come to earth to die on the cross, self-sacrifice, laying down of self, and the armor bearer is just following right behind. Luke 9:23 says that if any man is going to follow after me, he must deny himself, he must pick up his cross, and he must follow after me. And one of the revelations that Brother Cornell, and the reason I say his name is because I was full of spiritual pride. When I used to hear Robert talk about, oh, Bob Cornell said this, I said, I don't even know who that dude is, man. I can't even catch the radio station. I've been listening to that radio longer than Bob Cornell was there. And one day I went to a camp meeting and Bob Cornell said this and it was revelation for me and the Lord chastised me and said, he taught you something. Mm-hmm. What you think about that? I hate to admit to you that sometimes we can all have spiritual pride.
Amen. Amen. Yes.
And whenever he said this, he said that his cross is your cross. I got all kind of people telling me, oh, Jesus bore his cross. Now you got to add to it. You got to bear your own cross. You can't carry no cross. You got to learn how to associate yourself with Jesus. And as you go through the trials of life, you got to follow the pathway that he followed. Amen. He went the way of self-sacrifice. In him, the old man dies. A new man is resurrected. Amen. And listen, one side might be thorny, but you're getting a hold of the righteousness of Christ on the other side. Hallelujah. I just wanted you to see that. Next thing I wanted you to know is this, is that in verse 13 it says, and Jonathan climbed up upon his hands and upon his feet, and his armor bearer after him, and they fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer slew after him. See, whenever we trust by faith and follow the Lord goes before us. Jonathan, as a type of Christ, goes before us, and he begins to win the victory. Amen. He's winning the victory. He's slaying the enemy, and the armor bearer is behind him, walking in the victory of his Lord. Word of God says in Romans 8 and 37, it says that we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. You can't be a conqueror on your own, but in Christ, you're more than a conqueror, because you got to understand something. He is the victorious warrior. Amen. Amen.
Yes.
In verse 20, we talked about it already, but the fact is that when the Lord shows up, amen, he's the one that gives the victory. He is the one that causes confusion in the enemy's camp. And I just want to really close. These are some of the points that I wanted to make, but I wanted to close with just a couple of thoughts. Number one, whenever the Lord starts working in your life, and the grace of God begins to flow in your life, and he begins to give you victory, some amazing things start happening. You start running into people out there that have maybe left the church and have gone back to the world. But God will give you an opportunity to speak forth with excitement and zeal what God has done in your life. Amen. Some of you know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
When the Lord shows up and he begins to bring deliverance in your life, and you begin to talk about the Lord with zeal and passion,
yes.
And they realize something's different. What's happened? They may even make fun of you. I'm not telling you you're going to come to church with you. They might think you're crazy.
Yes.
But what's happening is that the Lord, they do know this. Something they got in that person. Something's different than what it was before.
Amen.
And I'm just wanting you to know something, that you keep on holding on to that and you keep on talking about Jesus.
Amen.
I remember whenever the Lord got a hold of me and I was talking to somebody at the old church. And I remember that person just saying, what is this all about, Matt? What is it about? It's about Jesus, man.
Amen.
Oh, you mad because we're not talking about the saints no more? Well, hello, Jesus died on the cross.
Yeah. Amen.
When you get excited about the Lord, amen, it'll get the people that even went back to the world stirred up. And they might want to come back. And then guess what? There was those people in the caves hiding in fear.
Yeah.
And when the Lord starts putting the word in your mouth to speak to them also, you give a word of encouragement to them, and the next thing you know, they start coming out the caves.
Yes.
They may not come to your church, but you never know what they're doing at home.
That's right.
Listen to me, man. One time I was working. I can't fit it in my pocket, but back in the day, remember them little checkbook Bibles we had? Me and Aaron used to have a little checkbook Bibles. I kept mine in my pocket. And I was like, I don't know. I probably was full of pride. Lord, I don't see how people even play. I was such a mess. I'd pull that thing out and I'd say, this is my master's card. I won't leave home without it. I had that Bible, dude. I had that whole Bible almost memorized. I'd cut people up with the word, man. I was tearing it up. And you know, but the point is this, is that I had that Bible in my back pocket. I had to become a soldier.
Yes.
Amen. Mm-hmm. And I forgot my train of thought. That's okay. I didn't stop. Listen, they went to the world, but they came back out. They were in fear, but they came out of the caves. And the last thing I really wanted to tell you, man, is this. Really, maybe two things. Is that when you truly walk in the pathway of the Lord, he'll cause grace like honey.
Yeah.
Amen. Mm-hmm. To fall. It's just falling from the sky on the ground. That's what grace does. You can't earn it.
That's right.
You understand that, right? You can't purchase grace.
Right.
But grace isn't just forgiveness. I need to remind you of that. I know I've written it a lot of times on the board, but grace isn't just forgiveness. It's a divine influence. Remember that?
A divine influence.
A divine influence where?
On the heart.
On the heart. And its reflection where?
In the life.
In the life.
Good.
Hallelujah. Somebody listening for the last 8 years.
Amen. Amen.
Praise God. A divine influence on the heart and its reflection in the life. What does that mean, preacher? It means grace enters into the inside of a man and does something on the inside of the man to the point where his life and his actions and everything begins to change outwardly.
Amen.
True. Hallelujah. True grace is an inside job. God has took that honeycomb and he put it in his mouth and he said, don't you see how my eyes were enlightened? He was given strength to his mortal body. He was ready to go on for more battle. The Lord wants to give you grace. He wants to give me grace so that we can engage the battle.
Amen.
Listen to me. Two scriptures and then we're closing. 1 Corinthians 1 verse 18. Jonathan's eating grace. And he's being empowered by the Lord to engage the battle. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 18. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
How is it the power of God? Because the preaching of the cross says that the old man born of Adam dies and is resurrected in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
His new position now makes him righteous, and to the righteous one God gives grace.
Yep.
Grace flows in the life of the righteous one and empowers him.
Thank you.
Gives him power to walk right.
That's right.
Enlightens him. Just like the honey on Jonathan's lips, the grace of God on the believer's heart enlightens him and empowers him. Now let's turn to 1 Corinthians 15 real quick. See, that's what Jonathan's walking in. Jonathan's walking in grace. Saul is walking in law. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 56. It says, the sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. Think about that. Ponder that for a moment. The power of God is what? It's the message of the cross. The word of the cross. The truth of the cross. Not just the word cross. Cross! 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 That doesn't do anything for you. This. To understand the spiritual significance of the victory that was won in the spiritual realm when Jesus died on the cross in your behalf.
Mm.
Understanding that, believing that, results in grace flowing in you, empowering you. The power of God is in the message of the cross because what is it again? It's his plan.
Yes.
Yes.
He's not changing his mind. It works. Amen? The power of God is in the... What is the power of sin, though?
Yes. The law.
Power of sin. That's right. Sin is strengthened by the law. Well, what does that have to do with me? I don't try not to eat pork. See, the law is all about performance. And the apostate church teaches that if you perform right, then you'll get what you're looking for from God. You go to church enough, you pray enough, you fast enough, you speak in tongues enough, you do this, you do that. All those things are godly things. All those things are spiritual things. But they're not the thing that gives victory over sin or gives access to the power of God. When you pray more, you should be led to more Jesus. When you fast more, you should be led to more Jesus. When you go to church more, you should be led to more Jesus. And you should be able to understand better what he did for you at the cross.
Amen.
That's what gives access to grace.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.